Welcome to my lecture. You have seen the previous slides, previous lecture also, and today I am going to talk about the primary embryonic induction. The primary embryonic induction, the most spectacular transplantation experiments were published by Ants, Spemann and Mangold in 1924. They showed that of all the tissues in the early gastrula, only one has its fate determination. So that means only one or few cells have the determination to give rise to some of the organs in the body. This self-differentiating tissue, this is what we call it as a self-differentiating tissue, is the dorsal lip of blastopore. So this is the dorsal lip of the blastopore. The tissue derived from the gray crescent of the cytoplasm. I said that gray crescent in the first class actually. When this dorsal lip tissue was transplanted into a presumptive belly skin region of another gastrula, it is not only continued to be a blastopore lip but also initiates gastrulation and embryogenesis in the surrounding tissue. So that means any self-differentiating tissue can give rise to the complete organ that what we have seen in the previous lecture. Two conjoined embryos were formed instead of one year. As a result of this thing, like you can get conjoined embryos were developed year. You can see that in the picture, it is determined that in the dorsal blastopore lip, it is towards the frontal region. If take this piece and transplant into presumptive epidermis somewhere here, in the next, gastrula stage, the secondary structure will develop like this, and the secondary structure in the, blastoporal groove, it develops into a bottle cells, and finally what it gives rise to what we call it as the congenital embryo at the end actually. The Spemann and Mangold use differently pigmented embryos from the newest species, that is a Triturus and Triturus species actually. So, when they prepared these transplant, they were able to identify host and the donor tissue on the basis of color actually. When the dorsal lip of early Teniatus gastrula was removed and implanted into the region of the early T. Cristatus gastrula, fated to become a ventral epidermis actually. As we have seen in the previous class, the belly skin. The pigmented donor tissue then continued to self-differentiate into cardiomesoderm, that is what in the future we call it as notochord, and other mesodermal structures that normally forms from the dorsal lip. That means once it is transplanted, it forms into a cardiomesoderm that finally become notochord, and other mesodermal structures like what we call it as the dorsal lip actually. So as these mesodermal cells moved forward, host cells began to participate in the production of new embryo. See, ultimately we come to know that the mesodermal cells, that is the cardiomesodermal area, move forward and the host cells, whatever it is, the original cells of the, transplanted animal embryo, will become a new embryo. In this secondary embryo, the somite could be seen containing both pigmented, that is from the donor and unpigment that is from the host tissue. It is a good experiment that is conducted by the Spemann and Mangold. Spemann referred to the dorsal lip cell and the derivative, that is a notochord, precordal mesoderm, we call it as an organizer. So the notochord area, that is what we call it as precordomesoderm area, he called that is organizer. Because there are several reasons why they called as organizer. Because some of them just I mentioned here, they induce the host ventral tissue to change their fates to form a neural tube. Look at that. It forms the neural tube, and the dorsomesodermal tissue such as somites formation takes place, because once the organizers are induced to other embryo, so that definitely give rise to a neural tube and dorsomesodermal tissue. One thing. Point number two is the organizer within the host embryo also derived to give neural tube and dorsomesodermal, what is the tissue, that is what we call it as somites. So friends, we are going to see what is the somites in the future class actually. And the second thing is they organized host and donor tissue into secondary embryo with clear anterior, posterior and dorsoventral axis. So you see that clearly. Just I explained the dorsoventral axis and the axis formation in amphibia. Here the organizer could be the reason for making the anterior and posterior, or developing the anterior and posterior and dorsoventral axis of the body of any organism including amphibia. Further, he proposed that during the normal development, these cells, that is the cardomesodermal cells, that is what we call it as organizer, organizes the dorsal ectoderm into neural tube and transform into flaking mesoderm into the anterior posterior body axis. That's what we call it as a flaking mesoderm, which give rise to anterior and posterior part of the body. It is known, that is thanks largely to Spemann and his students, that the interaction of cardomesoderm and ectoderm is not sufficient to organize the entire embryo. So that means it is not only the ectoderm or the cardomesoderm is not only the thing to develop the complete embryo, rather it initiates a series of sequential inductive events actually. It requires the inductive events of the series inductive events by organizer which is already existing in the mesoderm. Because there are numerous inductions during embryonic development. This key induction wherein the progeny of dorsal lip cell induces the dorsal axis and the neural tube is traditionally called as primordial embryonic induction. So whatever it is, see, the induction wherein the progeny of dorsal lip induces the dorsal axis and the neural tube is transitionally called the primary embryonic induction. Dear friends, so this is about the today's lecture. You kindly follow the next lecture to continue the same topic. Thank you very much.